Happy Father's Day, Harvest. Great to see you this morning. So glad to be here after an amazing weekend last week up at Camp Harvest, but it's good to be back in the Lord's house worshiping. Thanks, worship team, Kim, Austin, all of you for leading us so well. There are certain decisions made on certain days that change the course of history. Certainly in our nation's history, there's many days like that. I'm going to list a couple of them. As you might guess, one of the days I picked was July 4th, 1776, when 56 men staked their fortunes, their honor, and their lives to declare independence from the tyranny of England, beginning a new nation. We just celebrated 75 years of June 6th, 1944, when Dwight David Eisenhower, the commander-in-chief of the Allied forces, gave the order for the troops to storm the beaches of Normandy in France, turning the tide of the war and altering the history of not only our nation, but many nations. December 1st, 1955, a tired Rosa Parks got on a bus, and she sat down in a seat that by law was only for a person of a different colored skin. She was asked to move. She didn't. It was a defining day, a defining choice in the history of a nation. But over 3,200 years ago, there was a day and there was a choice made and a declaration spoken by a man named Joshua. He put a stake in the ground and he challenged a nation, all the people, but particularly he challenged the elders, the leaders, the men, the fathers. And he said, choose this day whom you will serve. And on Father's Day 2019, I don't want to be overly dramatic, but I want to pray that today, while it not maybe be a monumental day in our nation's history, I'm praying that it may be a monumental day in the life of a church. A monumental day in the hearts of fathers of this church. And I pray because of the power of the Word of God and the Spirit of God. So let's pray right now. Father, we thank you for your amazing hand in preserving the Word of God. I'm in awe that 3,200 years ago this event happened, just like we are woke up today. It was a day. And a man named Joshua gathered a nation of people before him, and he declared some things. And you have caused, by your Spirit, for those words to be written down and to be preserved all these years, that we could now hold them and be instructed and be moved by them. And so I pray that the hearts of these people, particularly the hearts of our men, fathers, fathers-to-be, Lord God, that you would cause us to make some declarations and to make some decisions and to choose you like never before. Oh God, would you do that? Would you be so kind to do that in this place to the men that I love and in my own heart? We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. The title of the sermon today is Fathers Choose This Day. We're going to be in Joshua chapter 24. So you'll open up your Bibles grab Bibles in the pews in front of you. Pews, what the heck? I've done that before. We don't have pews. I grew up in a church with pews. But in the chair in front of you, grab a Bible. I'd love everybody's eyes to be on their own copy or just with their neighbors would be great. Turn to Joshua chapter 24. We're going to be in verses 14 through 28. Our first point of the message is choose to serve. And before we get into verse 14, just want to kind of give you the context. At the beginning of chapter 24, you could see Joshua gathers all the tribes of Israel to Shechem. It's actually the place where Abraham first came into the land of Canaan. He gets called Abraham, the father of Israel, the father of the church, gets called from a land and he goes to a new land, and his very first stop is this place called Shechem. And at this place, God tells Abraham that he's going to give him the land that he sees. That's Shechem. And now Joshua calls these very people, the people of his, the descendants of Abraham, back to this place called Shechem. And he calls them all and he reminds them of the faithfulness of God from the days of Abraham to their very day. That's verses 1 through 13. And that brings us to where we're going to be in verse 14. Let me read it, 14 and 15 first for point number one, choose to serve. Now, therefore, fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in faithfulness. Put away the gods that your father served beyond the river and in Egypt and serve the Lord. And if it is evil in your eyes to serve the Lord, choose this day whom you will serve, whether the gods of our fathers served in the region beyond the river or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Back to verse 14. What's the first word? Say it loud. Now. Say it loud.
Now.
Now. Now. Is today the day, men? Dads, is now the time? Now? Is this the time now to put your stake in the ground? To take a stand? To confront your sin, to turn it around, to start afresh? To choose this day what the Lord has been longing for you to choose? Is it now? I don't know what you did this week. I don't know what you did this morning, but you are here now, and we are opening the Word of God, and the Spirit of God is in this place. Is now the time, fathers? Or will it slip by, and you might say it might be next week, next month, maybe God next year, maybe next life? The time is now. Hebrews 3:7 says, today if you hear his voice, do not harden your heart. And that's my prayer. Look at verse 14. Now therefore, fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity and faithfulness. I love this. I'm so blessed that I get to preach the Word of God, and I love it when I get to preach the Word of God on things that have made a difference in my life. And the first thing it says after now, therefore, is fear the Lord. Fear the Lord. What does fearing the Lord mean? This is Tony Evans' definition. To take God seriously. So you're wondering what fear the Lord means. It's not like you're scared like a scary movie. It means to take the Lord seriously. Give him appropriate respect, reverence, honor, and awe for his personhood, who he is, and his position, where he is. And to understand that because he loves you, he will hold you accountable. That is the fear of the Lord. This entire passage from 14 to 28 is all about serving the Lord, okay? So the first point is choose to serve. The passage is all about serving. 14 times, you want to underline it maybe later, you could circle it or underline it, the word serve is in these 14 verses 14 times. So the main message of the passage is to serve, but it starts out here to fear the Lord. We must fear the Lord if we're going to serve the Lord. Look at it in the text. Thou therefore fear the Lord and serve him. They're not two things. You fear the Lord and you serve him. If you serve him out of fear, you will serve him with sincerity and faithfulness. Let me kind of hopefully demonstrate to you the connection between fear of serving by talking about a different theme. My interactions with my wife, Chris. So, if I love my wife, Chris, I will be kind to her. If I love my wife, I will be kind to her. The motivation of my kindness, Adam, your motivation of your kindness to Liz should be your love. All right? If you love someone, you're going to be kind to them. But answer me this question. Can I be kind to my wife and not do it out of love? Yes or no? Raise your hand if you think yes. I can be kind to my wife and not do it out of love. People who have your hands up, you are correct. People that, oh yeah, I saw right at the last minute, Simone, you tried to put it up. You didn't have it up. You are on the wrong side, Simone. Right at the last minute, I'll put it up. Yes, I can be kind to Chris, not being motivated by love. Because I might be kind to her because I want something back. I might be kind to her because I want you to see something and think I'm more than maybe I am. So I'm doing it so you could see me. I might be kind to Chris because I really want her to serve me. So I am practicing a biblical principle on kindness, but the motive is completely selfish. So serving the Lord, you saw it. Rick, when he got baptized, did you guys hear his testimony? He said, I was serving and I was leading the social ministry of my church, and he didn't even know Jesus. You can serve the Lord, but unless you fear the Lord, look at the verse, there's no sincerity or faith. Sincerity is the heart. You're serving with the right heart when you fear him. And faithfulness is the hands, the actual actions in heart, inside and out. That comes from fearing the Lord. So if we're going to choose to serve God, it starts with fearing the Lord. Fathers, how many of you are fake serving your wives? Worse, how many of us are fake serving God? If it hurts as I say that, we've got to go back to the fear of the Lord, and here's five fear factors to help us. To help us grow our fear of the Lord, I'm going to run through them quickly because I went way over on the first service. But there's no second service, so we can be here till 3. I didn't even do this in the first service, but you guys get it because there's no second service after you. Here's the fear factors. Number one is power. If you want to grow in the fear of the Lord, you just got to contemplate his power. These verses, by the way, are killer. Write them down, and you need to go over it this week in your quiet time. This verse in Job is unbelievable about God's power. It ends with the thunder of his power. Who can understand is the very last verse. It's so cool. Secondly, if you want to grow your fear, number two, you got to contemplate his holiness. Isaiah 6:3, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory. If you want to fear the Lord, just start to think about his holiness, his purity, his consuming fireness. There's no one like him. He's completely different. Everyone who comes in his presence in the Bible falls flat on their face. Woe is me, that's the next thing. You want to fear him, think about your own sinfulness in light of a holy God, and you'll grow your fear. Isaiah comes into his presence, and he sees the Lord high and lifted up, and the train of his robe fills the temple, and he falls flat on his face. Woe is me, I am a man of unclean lips. He goes, I am lost first, and then he says, I'm a man of unclean lips, and I dwell among a people of unclean lips. Grow your fear by allowing yourself to actually look at yourself in the light of God. And then lastly, fear factor is this: in light of all those things, look at his mercy. Oh my goodness, that even though I don't deserve it, he extends this mercy to me. He withholds the punishment that's due. I forgot the wrath. Oh my gosh, that's another one. You want to fear God? Contemplate his wrath. Do you realize the wrath of God is being stored up for those who reject him? And we look at the cross and we see the wrath of God poured out onto the Son. And we saw the scourging and we saw the beating and we saw him lifted up and nailed to a cross. The wrath of God is coming, and that's going to make it look like child's play. That's sobering to make sure that we know Jesus Christ and have our faith squarely on Jesus Christ and him alone. That will bring fear. And the reason we need fear is because we're to serve the Lord, and it starts with fear of the Lord. He must be feared. But here's the second thing in the passage. Not only to serve him must he be feared, he must be first. Look at the second part of verse 14. Put away the gods that your father served beyond the river and in Egypt, and serve the Lord. So this is, listen to this. They put away the gods that they served beyond the river. That's talking about Abraham's parents. The nation of Israel began with idol worship. And he's saying to the people, now you got to put those away. Not only that, your moms and dads, when they were in Egypt, worshiped other gods too. And if you're going to be able to serve the Lord, you have to first fear him, and secondly, first him. He talks about it more, verse 15, and if it is evil in your eyes to serve the Lord, choose this day whom you will serve, whether the gods of your fathers served in the region beyond the river or the gods of the Amorites. That's the people they just conquered. So if you know the story of Joshua, Joshua led the people into the Canaan, the promised land, and God went before them and wiped out the nations before them and gave the Jewish people the land that he had promised to them. And the Amorites is a catch-all term for all the people that they just conquered, and they've been worshiping them. But if you're going to serve the Lord, and I'm going to serve the Lord, we have to put away our idols. He must be first, not just feared. He's got to be first. Fathers, what are the idols that are keeping God from being first in your life? Is it your wife? Is your entire happiness dependent upon how your wife treats you? If it is that way, she's an idol. Dads, husbands. What about this? Your job. If you're in the dumps all the time because you got a bad boss, and you come home every day cranky, and you come in and you take it out on your family because what's going on at work is controlling you, that is called a, it starts with an I, it's called a idol. You're not controlled by Jesus. You're controlled by that goofy boss. That's who's first in your life. That's called an idol. Dads that aren't here today, I'm talking to you. Sounds weird. I'm talking to you, dads that aren't here today, because your idol is the success of your kids, and you got them in a soccer tournament this morning at church. Instead of bringing your kids and sitting their butts in the church, you're out trying to think they're going to get them some soccer goofy scholarship. That's called an idol. And God says, if you're going to serve me, you need to fear me, and you need to first me. See, here's the issue, by the way, with the nation of Israel. Did they serve God, the living God? Yeah. They served God. They never turned their back on God, but they also invited others, other gods in. It wasn't that they didn't serve the Yahweh. It's that they served Yahweh and God, we'll learn in a little bit, is a jealous God. And if we're going to serve him, we're going to choose to serve him. We've got to fear and first him. In the early years of my fatherhood, my God was obedient kids. When we first came to Harvest in Crystal Lake, we ran a ministry for parents. How many of you are in here were in one of our parenting classes? A few in the back. Yep. All right. Good. Couple. We had parenting classes, and we did it for a long, long time. We actually did a little one. Tamara was back there saying we just did one a little bit ago, but this was early in our life here in Crystal Lake, in the early 2000s. And I was so prideful that the way my kids acted was like a little idol to me. The discipline of my children to keep them in line, to have people come and say, wow, your kids are so well behaved. That was an idol to me. And so when they didn't behave, guess what happened to me? Anger. Frustration. It caused relationship problems with my children at a young age because I was so idolizing me, basically, but children's behavior that it got in the way. Not until I grew in the fear of the Lord and worship of the Lord did that fine desire. There's nothing wrong with discipline. The Bible says that you're supposed to raise your kids up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. There's nothing wrong with it, but it becomes more important that you sin when you don't get it. That's called it starts with an I. Thank you. It's subtle. But I want to serve the Lord, so I want nothing in the way. What is in the way, guys, fathers? Worship him. Fear him. Choose to serve means he must be feared, he must be first. Once that happens, service to the Lord is filled with joy. Look at the verse 14. It's filled with sincerity and faithfulness. That's point number one, choose to serve. Here's point number two, consider the reason. Consider the reason. Let's read beginning in verse 16. Then the people answered, far be it from us that we should forsake the Lord to serve other gods. For it is the Lord our God who brought us and our fathers up from the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery, and who did those great signs in our sight and preserved us in all the way that we went, and among all the peoples through whom we passed. And the Lord drove out before us all the peoples, the Amorites who lived in the land. Therefore, we also will serve the Lord, for he is our God. Point number two is consider the reason. We serve by fearing him, by making him first, also because he's faithful. We serve him because he's faithful. Think about this group of people for a second. Joshua is gathering to Shechem, the nation of Israel, and the elders and the leaders and the fathers, almost all of them, would have been children in Egypt, slave children. Think about what all they saw. They saw their parents getting beaten and whipped. They saw some of their little brothers get killed because Pharaoh didn't want the nation to grow. What else did they see? They saw the plagues. They participated in the Passover. They left with the spoils of Egypt. They came to the Red Sea. They were stuck. Here comes Pharaoh's chariots and his army. They're back up against the sea. Moses with the staff opens the sea. They walk through on dry ground. The sea comes over the chariots. They saw manna. amazing provision every day, food. They saw the ten. They saw Moses bring the Ten Commandments. They saw the golden calf. They saw the serpent held up in the desert. They saw water from a rock. They saw the Jordan part so they could go across. They saw the walls of Jericho fall down. They saw it all. Unless we think ourselves better. They saw it all and they still didn't just worship Yahweh alone. But we do the same. We consider the reasons and God is so faithful to us, but yet we still have competing idols. But when we remember the reasons, when we consider the reasons, as our point said, that helps us to serve the Lord. Has God been faithful to you? Has God been faithful to you? Well, let's start with this. If you know Jesus Christ as Savior, he's already given you the best thing ever. That Jesus Christ died on the cross and that by your faith, you have been saved, and in 100 years, like John was saying earlier, you're going to be standing in his presence in paradise, and you don't deserve it. That is considering a reason to serve him. But it doesn't stop there. Romans 8:32, he who did not spare his own son, but gave himself up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? He gave us his best in Jesus Christ, but he wants to give you so much more. And he has given you so much more. And when you consider the reason, it motivates you like fear and putting him first. His faithfulness motivates you to serve. The issue is, if I'm not serving with my whole heart, it's because I'm maybe not really considering his faithfulness enough. Every believer, every Christian father should have two chronicles or two collections on their shelf of faith library. Two books. Number one, I'm going to call it a Jesus journal or a deliverance diary or miracle memoirs. Pick any name you want. What is this? Look at the text. You can see there, out of the house of slavery, who did these great signs in our sight and preserved us in all the way that we went. You need to, I need to have a Jesus journal of all the things that he's done in my life that come under the quotations, only God. That's their thing. Only God stories. It's going to motivate you to serve. It's dad's job to identify, remember, and retell the God stories in your family. It's dad's job to identify, remember, and retell the God stories in your family. That is our responsibility, men. And if we do that, we'll remind ourselves and remind our wives and our children and all who will listen of God's faithfulness, which motivates us to serve. Here's the second book. The first is the Jesus Journal. Here's the second book on the shelf in your faith library. It's a book of blessings. There's the Jesus Journal, which is all the faithful God sightings, John, in your family throughout the years. There should be a host of them, but maybe there's four or five big ones that you tell all the time. But the book of blessings, it's different. The book of blessings is this. It's the signs or the facts of God's faithfulness today. Today. Try this on for some blessings. My marriage, my kids, my parents, my siblings, my church, my small group, my pastor, my ministry, my giftings, my Bible, my job, my health, my house, my warm bed, my warm shower, my boss, my co-workers, my teachers, my classmates, my coaches, my teammates, my past, my present, my future, my last breath, my next breath. That's the book of blessings. And when you are able to call upon not only the remembrances of the past, but of his faithfulness today, it moves you to serve him with sincerity and with faithfulness, as Joshua called the nation back then, and as God is calling this group of people now. One of my Jesus journals, real quickly, I call it the bank job provision. The bank job makes it sound like I robbed a bank for Jesus. That's not true. But the bank job provision is when we moved into ministry, we left Gatorade. I was making a lot of money, and we made about a fourth. We raised our own support, and we made a fourth of what we used to make. The God had provided for us, we paid down our mortgage and had a lot of savings because we knew our lifestyle was going from X to X minus Y. And it was a big difference. And so the Lord had provided for us. How many of you have been to our house? Been to my house, all right? A bunch of you. It's called the Gatorade house. The reason it's called the Gatorade house, because the Lord provided and the Lord got us that house through Gatorade. We committed it to ministry. We filled that place with ministry. But when we left to go and to start Competitors for Christ, quickly, we couldn't make the jump so fast in our lifestyle, and so our savings was going down, 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 down. We came to the realization that we couldn't keep the Gatorade house because the taxes on the Gatorade house were so ridiculous that most of us should move to Florida. But we realized that we weren't going to be able to stay in the house. So Michelle Gasson-Smith of our church, we asked her to start looking for houses. We started preparing to put our house up for sale. In the midst of this, almost the day after we put the house or got the process started, I get a call from some friends from a local bank. And I've known them for a long time, grew up with the president. And he knew I was in marketing. And he asked, could you spend a little bit of time with us to help us with some of our marketing for the bank? We're a new bank and we just need some help. Would you give us like 15 hours a week or maybe 12 hours a week? We'll pay you $100 an hour. And I'm like, you know what? I'm really involved in the ministry. It's super, super busy. I would really love to help you because I love you, Andy, but I just don't have the time. That night I go to bed and I wake up and I'm like, the story of the big flood and the dude that sits on top of his house, you ever heard this story? He's on top of his house. There's flooding all around. And he's waiting, praying to God to rescue him. And boats are coming by, rescue boats. And he's like, no, God will take it for me. I just wait on God. I don't need your boat. I'm just, God's going to save me. And then finally, he ends up dying. He goes up to heaven, and God says, I sent you a bunch of boats. Why didn't you get in? That's what happened here. God was making a provision for me. I didn't even see it. That night, I wake up. And I'm like 3:30 in the morning, and I start doing the math. $100 an hour, 12 hours a week, X number of weeks. Guess how much it added up to? Exactly the amount of the taxes. It was an amazing provision. It was in my Jesus journal, and I'm so glad to be able to remember it and tell it to my kids. There's many of those in your life. That's going to help you to serve. So choose this day, we choose to serve. Number two, we consider the reason. Number three, we count the cost. Count the cost. Let's start in verse 19 now. But Joshua said to the people, you are not able to serve the Lord. For he is a holy God. He's a jealous God. He will not forgive your transgressions or your sins. If you forsake the Lord and serve foreign gods, then he will turn and do harm and consume you after having done you good. And the people said to Joshua, no, but we will serve the Lord. Then Joshua said to the people, you are witnesses against yourself that you have chosen the Lord to serve him. And they said, we are witnesses. He said, then put away the foreign gods that are among you and incline your heart to the Lord, the God of Israel. And the people said to Joshua, the Lord our God we will serve, and his voice we will obey. Joshua highlights the seriousness of the decision that they're going to make. And let me warn you that you have a propensity to wander, that you need to count the cost. Count the cost. That's the point. He reminds us, look at in verse 19, why do we have to count the cost? Because if we don't serve him, he is a holy God and he's a jealous God. He's holy. He's a consuming fire. He's not to be dealt with trivially. It matters. Number two, he's a jealous God. You know that you're the bride of Christ. And you are married to Jesus Christ. He looks at you as his bride. You guys that are married, you know how you look. I hope you look upon your wife and cherish her and love her. Jesus loves you as a bride with a perfect love. And he is jealous for you. And so when we have competition for his affection with idols, he is jealous, and it's not a sinful jealousy like me and you. It is a righteous jealousy because he created you for one purpose. That's fellowship with him. And when you are outside of it, he is jealous, like a jealous husband. So you don't take covenants trivially, men. If you decide to do something today with what you're going to hear and you're going to put something into practice, you better take it seriously. Because God is not a God to be trifled with. You could see there in verse 19, he says, he will not forgive your transgressions or your sins. Before Jesus, the law, if you broke the law, it was death. And he's reminding the people of the seriousness of their transgression, particularly if they reject God and go all in on other idols. What happens to rejection of God fully? It's called eternal hell. But for us, for those of you that know Jesus Christ, we're in the age of grace. God extends to us forgiveness for our sin, but there are consequences for our sin. Just as much as the age of grace is a theological construct in the Bible, so is another one called the law of the harvest. It's called you reap what you sow. If you sow, the Bible says if you sow to the Spirit, you reap righteousness. If you sow to the flesh, you reap destruction. And God is so good to watch and to reward us for our good. Look at it in there. In the verse, it says it right there. If you forsake the Lord and serve the gods, then he will turn and do you harm and consume you after done you good. He's done you good when you have chosen to follow him, but when you don't, be ready. It's coming. It's the law of the harvest. You reap what you sow. Fathers, we need to tell our children this principle. You reap what you sow. 3 years ago, my son left for the University of Kansas as a freshman. And when he got there, he made some poor decisions. And I had to send him a letter when I found out. I found out through an amazing provision of the Lord. He still doesn't know this day how I found out, and he will never know. But the Lord is good. Your sin will find you out. So I sent him this letter. Listen to the reap and sow principle that I talked to him in this letter. He gave me permission to read it. And by the way, I'll read it and then talk about it. September 12, 2016, Christopher, it's a very difficult letter to write. Your mom and I chose to write you a letter to make sure we are clear, make sure we didn't sin as we shared this with you, and to pray over it before we sent it. We recently learned that you have been lying to us and being deceitful about your drinking and partying. The Lord is gracious to us to allow us to find out what you have been doing. Great relationships are built on trust. Sadly, you have broken that trust. We've always believed what you have told us, no matter the topic. You took advantage of that trust. You had earned that trust over the years, but unfortunately, we don't have it now. I'm sure you can earn it back over time, but it will take a while. Just to be clear, I want to remind you why this is sin. It is sinful on multiple levels. And then I gave him eight different reasons with Bible verses to go with the eight different reasons that what he was doing was sin. I won't get into that. I share this with you to help you see that what has been going on isn't just some innocent fun. It is against the Word of God. You may think it's no big deal or that it was worth it to make some memories. It obviously was serious to God, and because it's serious to him, it's serious to us. If you need to lie and deceive us, break all these commandments to have fun or be accepted, or if it's just worth it, that too is sad. Don't be naive and think you can build your faith as you live in both worlds. God will not be mocked. How can a young man keep his way pure? By guarding it according to your word, Psalm 119:9. You are not strong enough to dabble in the world and still grow in Jesus. No one can serve two masters. I am not strong enough either. No one is. Where do we go from here? Here's the part about reaping and sowing. Where do we go from here? That is up to you. You have some decisions to make. You are free to live any life you choose. You must know that the way you live will have consequences, good or bad. Your faith is at a crossroads. Is being a Christian mean to be diligent and pure, or is it okay to be in the world some too? I believe the word is clear, but I cannot and will not force you to believe and live out that belief. You have to figure that out. We are praying for you. I suggest you find a quiet place to pray and think about all of this and what has gone on and what is in this letter. Read the word. Once you've had some time, you'll be able to come to some decisions. As it relates to making things right with God, he loves you, and he has sent his son to die for your sin. He did that so you could be forgiven. He will lovingly forgive you if your heart is repentant and you confess. 1 John 1:9. God isn't mad at you. He just wants to fill your life with satisfaction and joy that worldly stuff can't ever bring. Sin is sometimes pleasurable for the moment, but it leads to heartache, regret, and if not addressed, toward increased destruction. But godly sorrow is met by a loving God who forgives and is ready to go forward with you toward a better day tomorrow. Go to him. As it relates to your relationship with your mom and I, we love you so much. We only want what is best for you. You are a great son, but we have been really hurt by this. Like God, we will surely forgive you before him and to your face if you ask. Our prayer, our most regular and fervent prayer, is always that you keep growing increasingly closer to Jesus. We are praying that God has allowed this to wake you up and warn you and to show you that the world is so strong so you would again draw near to Jesus more than ever and pledge to him. A life of single-minded devotion and purity. You will never regret a decision like that, but again, it's your call. When you've had time to walk through all of this, we look forward to talking to you about it. We can schedule a time to Skype. Nothing you could ever do or not do could ever make us love you less or more. We just flat out love you. But just know how disappointed we are. But we have so much hope because we have an awesome God and an awesome kid too. Love mom and dad. Do you hear the concept of reaping and sowing? I'm not trying to get Christopher to do anything except by prayer. It's his choice. And by God's grace, he made a choice. He came home that year and said, I'm no longer going back there. It's too hard. I'm going to a Christian school. Now he's at liberty, studying to be a pastor. He didn't go in to be a pastor. He's come out. That changed his life, praise God. And it doesn't always work that way. But prayer is answered. And you teach your kids the reap and sow principle that the Bible teaches, and you allow them to make their own decisions, and you weep with them when they make the wrong ones. And you're there to help them and love on them. But you got to count the cost. Fathers, are you counting the cost of your parenting in your home? Are you counting the cost of the parenting in your home? What do I mean? Well, you reap what you sow. And if your home is a child-centered home, and your children get whatever they want because they manipulate you, and they cry or they whine, and you give in ultimately, you may try for a while, but if your kids run the show, trust me, you're going to reap what you sow. And you're not teaching them at a young age, they need to learn to submit. And I'm not talking to a harsh father. I'm talking to a loving father, but they need to learn to submit when they're young because they got to submit their life to Jesus Christ. And if they're child-centered, they'll never really submit because they think they're the center of the world. Are you counting the cost in your parenting in your home, men? Maybe some of you aren't child-centered. Maybe you're wife-centered. Maybe you abdicate the role that God has placed for you to your wife, and your wife does everything. You'll pray for her. You encourage her, but you don't do it. You give the job to your wife. You're going to reap what you sow. Maybe some of you are father-centered. Everything's got to be right. My kids need to be quiet. My wife needs to have dinner on the table. And if not, there's going to be some punishment. There's going to be some hell to pay if things aren't right in my home. I'm going to make sure that it gets right, no matter the cost. I'm going to get mad. I'm going to be manipulative, whatever it takes. I am the center. This home better run the way I want it. Count the cost. You'll reap what you sow. God is not mocked. It's an opportunity to put Christ in the center of your home, guys. Count the cost. Lastly, point four is confirm your commitment. Verse 25. So Joshua made a covenant with the people that day and put in place statutes and rules for them in Shechem. And Joshua wrote these words in the book of the law of God. And he took a large stone and set it up there and under the terebinth that was by the sanctuary of the Lord. And Joshua said to all the people, "Behold, this stone shall be a witness against us, for it has heard all the words of the Lord that he spoke to us. Therefore, it shall be a witness against you, lest you deal falsely with your God." So Joshua sent the people away, every man to his inheritance. Joshua makes it formal. He writes it up, both the commitment and the plan. See it there? So Joshua, verse 25, made a covenant with the people and put in place statutes and rules for them. There's a plan. He memorializes it. He puts a stone there so they don't forget. They don't forget God's promise and they don't forget their own promise. All significant change for God happens through a process. Put it up on the screen. If you want to make a change today, men, Mr. Lowry, Mr. Duke, Mr. Baker, Mr. Jones, if you want to make a change, this is the process. I'm praying that God is going to impress upon the men of this church, the fathers of this church, to make a change. And here it is. It starts with conviction. I see. Number two, it's confession. I'm sorry, God. Number three, commitment. I swear. I put a commitment down. I say what I want to do differently, and I begin a plan. I put a plan down. I don't just put a plan down and then go off and try to do it. I share it with my brothers. I get accountability, and when I do that, God, by his grace, Lord willing, will make change. Any other way, you short-circuit the process. It starts with repentance and moves to bearing fruit with repentance, and that's the way. Don't short-circuit it, men. Do the hard work. If you see nothing, ask God to show you. Ask God to convict you. Then confess it. Then commit to it or covenant with it. That's the middle one. Then get in community and then watch God change you. All right? Regarding this commitment, do you have a commitment for your family, men, fathers? 1994, my son Brian was 3 years old. My oldest son. And I wrote this down. It's on the screen, I think. Yep. It's laminated, it's old, it's faded. Why is the Bradshaw family special? This goes on our refrigerator. Michael sees it every time he walks out the door. Well, not right now because we have a new refrigerator. It's not on there, it's in my hand. But normally he would see it. We love Jesus and live by his word. We trust, respect, and cherish each precious member of our family. We choose to put our family first before work, play, and other friends. Yes, my family comes before Harvest Bible Chapel. And we have lots of fun together. Very simple. All right? Out on the info counter, there was a movie called Courageous a few years ago. And there is a resolution. If you don't want to do your own, there's an awesome Courageous resolution. It's on the info counter. I'm not going to read through it, but it goes through all of different roles as a father. It's a commitment. You should print it out if you don't have one. You should frame it. You get it up and talk about it with your family and put it up somewhere. Or do your own. How do you know where you're going if you don't commit and covenant to something? Look at verse 31 in closing. Israel served the Lord all the days of Joshua and all the days of the elders who outlived Joshua and had known all the work that the Lord did for Israel. Joshua's example and leadership made a difference. It made a difference. That generation followed the Lord. When you turn the page and you start going into Judges, they went back. They went back to the idols. They're strong, but not this generation. This commitment that was made this day, 3,200 years ago, God honored it, and they honored their commitment that generation, and God did an amazing work until those guys all died off. And I don't know about the next generation coming out of Harvest Bible Chapel, Crystal Lake, but I know this one, and I know the men of this church, and I am praying that the men of this church, the leaders of this church, the fathers of this church are going to make some covenants, and they're going to keep them, and we're going to watch the hand of blessing because we reap what we sow. And what we sow, if we sow to the Spirit, we're going to reap righteousness, which glorifies our God in heaven. And that's what we desire. Amen? Amen. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this word. We thank you for the declaration of Joshua and the call to the men of Joshua's day. But God, we thank you that that call is not just for the men of Joshua's day, but for the men of this day. And on Father's Day 2019, I am praying, God, that you would move the men. Help them identify one thing, if it's just one thing, that they would align with your word and by the power of your Spirit, follow through and watch how you, through your strength and through their submission and through them laying themselves on the altar, dying for you, dying for their wives, dying for their children, dying for their church, that sacrifice you would take, it would be pleasing in your sight, and you would use it to bear much fruit in the life of the man, the life of his family, the life of his church, and the life of his world. Thank you, Lord. We love you and we praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.